Welcome to worship at Westminster. We're glad you're here. Well, this week on Wednesday night, Gradye Parsons led our Wednesday evening devotion and used Psalm 47. It's absolutely one of my favorites. Clap your hands, you people. Clap your hands. Shout to God with loud songs of joy. And when I heard it, I immediately thought of being a youth. It was the first song I ever learned to sing in my youth choir, and I just love it. But then the second thought I had was, it sounds a little bit strange in these days to think about clapping your hands and singing to God with loud songs of joy. And then it occurred to me, you know, I've seen that recently, though. And you may have seen it, too, in this week's newsletter, The Abbey. And that is, there were pictures of the youth, three of them, working for one of our parishioners, doing some work in their yard. And they were just so joyful, so happy to be together, appropriately distanced, doing hard and meaningful work. It just means everything to them. And so since that's happened, the kids have all said they would love to continue doing that. So I want to just let all of you know that if you have any outdoor work that you could use some help doing, that we are ready and willing and available to do that. So just give us a call and we'd be more than happy to set that up. And then the other thing I wanted to talk about was the fact that this is Memorial Day weekend, and we are very excited to celebrate it. I want to thank all of you who have sent in those wonderful pictures, and even better, the wonderful stories of how your loved ones served our country, served all of us, and stood for peace and justice and keep us all safe. And of course, this year, we have many other people doing that very same thing on the front lines, in the hospitals, even in sanitation work, everything, keeping us safe, standing for our own personal peace, I guess. So it's really a poignant year to be celebrating Memorial Day. All right, well, let's turn our hearts and minds to the worship of Almighty God.
Thank you.
This is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Please join me in singing our first hymn.
Let us turn to the one who brings light into darkness, confessing to God and one another the truth about our lives. Let us confess our sins together.
Gracious God, these are our sins. When given health, we misuse it. When given a good creation, we abuse it. When given food, we hoard it. When given beauty, we flaunt it. When given freedom, we assume it. When given time, we squander it. When given life, we distort it. When given love, we place conditions around it. Forgive the ways that we fail to do justice, love kindness, and walk humbly with you, our God. Amen.
Sisters and brothers, the light of God's love shines into the dark places of our world, healing its brokenness and bringing hope to places of despair. The light of God's love makes us a forgiven people. Friends, believe the good news. In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven.
Thank you. first reading from the scripture today is from the book of Acts, chapter 1. Listen for the word of the Lord. When they had come together, they asked him, "Lord, is this the time when you will restore the kingdom to Israel?" He replied, "It is not for you to know the times or periods that the Father has set by his own authority. But you will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem, in all Judea and Samaria, and to the ends of the earth." When he had said this, as they were watching, he was lifted up, and a cloud took him out of their sight. While he was going and they were gazing up toward heaven, suddenly two men in white robes stood by them. They said, "Men of Galilee, why do you stand looking up toward heaven? This Jesus, who has been taken up from you into heaven, will come in the same way as you saw him go into heaven." And from the Gospel of John, chapter 17, after Jesus had spoken these words, he looked up to heaven and said, "Father, the hour has come. Glorify your Son, so that the Son may glorify you. Since you have given him authority over all people to give eternal life to all whom you have given him. And this is eternal life, that they may know you, the only true God, and Jesus Christ, whom you have sent. I glorified you on earth by finishing the work you gave me to do. So now, Father, glorify me in your own presence with the glory that I had in your presence before the world existed. I have made your name known to those whom you gave me from the world. They were yours, and you gave them to me, and they have kept your word. Now they know that everything you have given me is from you. For the words that you gave to me, I have given to them. And they have received them and know in truth that I came from you, and they have believed that you sent me. I'm asking on their behalf. I'm not asking on behalf of the world, but on behalf of those whom you gave me, because they are yours. All mine are yours, and yours are mine, and I have been glorified in them. And now I am no longer in the world, but they are in the world, and I am coming to you. Holy Father, protect them in your name that you have given me, so they may be as one as we are one."
Hello, boys and girls. As you can tell, I am not Allie. I'm not even Allie's twin sister. I'm Grady. I'm one of the people that's a minister around here at Westminster Presbyterian Church. Do you know how you got your name? Were you named after your dad or your mom, or maybe your granddad or your grandmom, or maybe some story that your parents read? We all got our name from somewhere. Well, I know where I got my name. I got my name from my Uncle Grady, who was my father's younger brother. And in the Second World War, he was part of the Marines. Here's his picture. He should have been in the Air Force with those big ears he had. But anyway, this is my Uncle Grady, and he was a young Marine. And he went off to a place called Saipan, which is an island in the Pacific Ocean, and there was a big battle there, and he got very badly hurt, and he wasn't able to make it home. So part of the things I have of his is also his Purple Heart, which you get when you are hurt fighting for the United States. This is Memorial Day weekend. This is the weekend we remember men and women who have put on uniforms and have gone to defend our country in wars all over the world. Now, I don't like war. I don't think anybody really likes war. It's crazy and it's painful and it causes a lot of damage. But at the same time, I do respect the people who are willing to serve our country in any of our military services or to serve as policemen or firemen or EMTs, any kind of first responders. I respect them, and I respect my Uncle Grady, and I respect what he did and the sacrifice he made. So this weekend is Memorial Day weekend. So think about the people in your family, maybe your grandparents or grandmothers who served in the military. Make sure you thank them and make sure you pray for the ones that are serving now. And let's pray for them now. Lord, we thank you for the people who put on uniforms and do all the hard things to keep our country and our world safe. Please keep them safe too. In Jesus' name, amen.
In a reading from 1 Peter, chapters 4 and 5. Beloved, do not be surprised at the fiery ordeal that is taking place among you to test you, as though something strange were happening to you. But rejoice insofar as you are sharing Christ's sufferings, so that you may also be glad and shout for joy when his glory is revealed. If you are reviled for the name of Christ, you are blessed, because the Spirit of glory, which is the Spirit of God, is resting on you. Humble yourselves, therefore, under the mighty hand of God, so that he may exalt you in due time. Cast all your anxiety on him, because he cares for you. Discipline yourselves. Keep alert. Like a roaring lion, your adversary, the devil, prowls around, looking for someone to devour. Resist him, steadfast in your faith, for you know that your brothers and sisters in all the world are undergoing the same kinds of suffering. And after you have suffered for a little while, the God of all grace, who has called you to his eternal glory in Christ, will himself restore, support, strengthen, and establish you. To him be the power forever and ever. Amen. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
There's a scene in the movie Forrest Gump where Forrest has been running for, I don't know, 2 years or something, whatever he does. And it's turned into kind of a movement, and there's a crowd of people eventually following him because they think he's found the secret to the meaning of life. And finally he stops and he turns around and says, "I'm kind of tired. I think I'll go home now." And he just starts walking away, and the crowd of people are looking around and they're puzzled, and somebody says, "Well, wait, what about us? What are we supposed to do now?" And I think about that when I encounter this passage in Acts, and Jesus, you know, ascends into heaven, and the disciples are standing there looking up in the clouds, you know, like, "Well, wait, what about us? What are we supposed to do now?" Before Jesus is taken up into the mystery of God, he's asked a question which I think, again, bubbles up in us in different kinds of ways. But he's asked, "When are you going to restore the kingdom?" And I suspect they meant by that the old Davidic kingdom, which was looked back on nostalgically as sort of the glory years of Israel. But also in Jesus' talk about the kingdom of God, this kingdom of peace and justice. Jesus, when are things going to be made right again? And it's a question that God's people ask often in times of suffering, through exiles and wandering in the wilderness. How much longer? You hear that reverberating throughout the Psalms. How long, O Lord? How long must we endure this? When will things be normal again? Or get back to normal, perhaps we would ask. And if you're listening closely, you'll notice that Jesus, unlike a lot of his followers through the centuries, who with way too much time on their hand get obsessed about predicting the end of time and the dates and those kinds of things, Jesus doesn't offer an answer per se. He simply says, "It's not for you to know the times." That is to say, only God knows. And he does that on more than one occasion to say, only God knows these things. And I guess we could wonder why he's not more specific. Perhaps he would say, what we do know is that normal is gone. You know, and we're dealing with that. You know, whatever normal was, it's not going to come back the same way. I mean, we could use a positive example of that. A young couple has their first child and, you know, may think at some point things would get back to normal. Well, never. You know, it's great, it's a blessing, it's wonderful, but your old normal is gone. But that pull of the normal is very powerful. You know, you think of the people, again, wandering in the wilderness. They've escaped slavery in Egypt, and Moses is leading them to the promised land. And after a while, they're like, "Can we go back to Egypt?" You're like, "Really? You want to go back to slavery? You go back to being mistreated. Well, it was normal, you know. We knew what to expect, at least. Out here, you know, we don't know what's going to happen from hour to hour, day to day. And we need to remember that normal wasn't perfect. Our normal found us, you know, in a world where, honestly, we were probably closer to some kind of nuclear incident than any of us want to think about. A world where there's still poverty and great wealth disparity, a nation divided, where, you know, we've seen a rise in the last few years of racism and anti-Semitism, a planet looking at an impending climate crisis. So normal, you know, normal wasn't perfect. But our faith and our hope is in a in a new normal, I suppose. But the when, that not knowing, is hard. God only knows. But Jesus said, what you can know in this time is that, how does he phrase it? You will receive power from the Holy Spirit, that God's presence will be with you, that God's Spirit will be with you in this time. So what do we do in the meantime? Well, he says, be my witnesses. Carry on the ministry that I've called you to. You know, in John's gospel, in the passage that Mary read, you know, Jesus is praying to God, and he said, I've finished the work now that you've called me to do. His ministry to the poor, to the disenfranchised, his proclamation of the kingdom of God, of this time of economic justice for all people. He gave his life for that vision, that the world would know life. Not just eternal life, but life abundant here. And he gave his life for that. And we are thankful for that. Actually, on this Memorial Day weekend, we find ourselves thankful for all those who've sacrificed and given their life. Those who've died in war. Those who've died to prevent war. And so Jesus prays that his followers will continue his ministry. And he also asks God to protect them and to look out for them and to keep them, because he knew that they would very likely face opposition and conflict, that the values and what he lived and died for could often come into conflict with the values of the kingdoms of this world. Which brings us to this little letter we call 1 Peter. It was written in a time of persecution. You know, the early Christians were often persecuted for their faith. I don't want to go too deeply into the weeds, but, you know, they were often persecuted by the Roman Empire because they were seen as a challenge to the very structure and the powers that be. This group running around talking about equality and economic justice, they were seen as a threat. And that persecution became more intense or less intense at various times. Sometimes it was, you know, insults, or they were marginalized in a particular area or such. And there were other times when it became just horrible kinds of persecution. It became very intense under Nero Caesar. Nero was just a narcissistic, cruel person who lacked any kind of empathy or any kind of moral character. And Rome was going through a very difficult period, and so Nero was looking for someone to blame, as despots do, you know, like Hitler, who, you know, wanted to blame the Jews and blame the communists and always blaming this or that for their own particular plight. And historians believe that Nero actually set fire to Rome and then blamed the Christians for it. And they were an easy target because they were already suspect. And so the persecution there became quite horrible, you know, the stories that we read about. And we believe that this little letter grew out of that period. In fact, there's a couple of in our passage today, there's a couple of references. He mentions the fiery ordeal that you're going through. And we know that there were Christians who were, you know, who were burned at the stake. He talks about your adversary like a roaring lion is out to get you. And again, we know of incidences we read about of Christians, you know, these horrible things being fed to lions and the gladiator games and these kinds of things. And you can sympathize with the author of, what in the world do you say to people in the midst of this? And to try to give some kind of encouragement or some kind of hope. And the whole letter deals with that. Deals with the sufferings that they're going through, personal sufferings of loss and grief, but the sufferings that they're encountering for following Christ and trying to adhere to their Christian values in a world where they're meeting opposition for that. And so as he concludes the letter here, one of the things we read today, he says, don't be surprised at what you're going through. People in all over the world are enduring the same kinds of things. We're all in this together. Christ suffered, so we will suffer. We know that our faith may bring us into conflict. And he also says that this is a test of our faith. I struggle with that just a bit because I honestly don't think he means that God tests us. And this thing we're going through, I've heard people say that, but I don't think that God is testing us, you know, causing this to happen in order to teach us lessons. I was talking with someone the other day, a good friend of mine, and we were having the same discussion and saying, you know, I don't think this is God teaching us a lesson. God is on the side of good and healing. God is that power that moves us toward justice. God is that power, that spirit that elicits kindness and compassion in us. Nevertheless, there are lessons to be learned. Anytime you go through something tragic, there are lessons to be learned. But the main lesson I think that this author is conveying is that God is with us in our suffering, that God is here with us. And again, so what do we do in the meantime? And the author here offers four little, I'm not sure what to call them, words of wisdom, adages for encouragement. They're not really advice because that sounds too much like some kind of cheesy self-help thing. You know, let go, let God. But it's four little admonitions which I think he feels can help steady them in these times. One is he says, humble yourselves. And here I think he means realizing how dependent we are on each other and on God. I mean, the opposite of humility is what? Pride. I need nothing or no one. But humility and for better or worse, this thing has humbled us, made us realize in a stark way how fragile life is, how vulnerable we all are, hopefully reminding us how dependent we are and interconnected we are with one another and dependent upon God and God's goodness. Then he says, cast all your anxiety upon the Lord. I wish, don't you wish, you know, if I could just cast 50% of it upon the Lord, you know, it doesn't have to be all of it. I'll carry 50 if you can take 50. Cast all your anxiety upon the Lord. But again, think about the context here, what these folks are going through. I mean, they're not sweating out whether they got a B+ or an A-. I mean, this is some life-threatening stuff that they're enduring. And he says, cast all your anxiety upon the Lord because God cares for you. God cares for you. And if you can find that childlike trust, that's what we hold on to, but that's what holds on to us. And it's not an easy place to get to. So I hear him saying, on the one hand, don't be overwhelmed by pride. On the other hand, don't be overwhelmed by panic either, because God cares for you. Next little admonition is kind of interesting. Discipline yourselves. I find that interesting because one of the things that has happened, and particularly when this thing kind of first started, was that we all seem very disoriented. You hear people almost joking, you know, like, what day is it? What time is it? You know, you're just kind of really disoriented. And as I've talked to folks, I have found colleagues and friends and others who have said one of the things that they have done is to be very intentional about structuring the day. Even if it's just little things, that it is so important to just sort of stay in the present and to have things and deadlines and things that you do with a kind of regularity. I heard one time, I think it was the late Senator John McCain, I'm pretty sure it was him, but he was talking about life in a POW camp. And he said one of the things that they did to just keep their sanity, you know, because you didn't know, you know, freedom, it seemed almost too much to hope for. And so one of the things, you try to, as much as you could, do the same things every day in a sense. You know, if you had access to reading materials, you would read, or if you did a little exercise, you'd walk around, or just mentally to play exercises as a kind of discipline, just to keep you in the here and now. And I think that's what the author's kind of getting at. Discipline yourself during these times, whether it's the disciplines of prayer or meditation or reading, or have some kind of schedule or something, but checking on neighbors, whatever, but that kind of keeps us in the present and keeps us focused on the good in the here and now. And finally, he says, resist. That your adversary, the devil, is out there roaring. And he means the Roman Empire, you know. Don't let this lure you away from your faith. Live the faith. This is not an excuse to be unloving or unforgiving. And again, in this context, you can imagine that people were feeling anger and, you know, vengeful and all of these things if you had suffered loss and the things that you were going through, but that's not who we are. God calls us to live out what Paul calls the fruits of the Spirit, gentleness and kindness and compassion. And these things are not dependent on the external circumstances of our lives. We're called to live them, as he says, day in and day out. And the values of inclusion, the values of equality, speaking out against injustice, will always be met, I think, in some sense, with opposition. So resist those voices that want to divide us. Resist those voices that deny our commonality, you know, and as I said a couple of sermons ago, our common creator and our common humanity. And when you to focus on these things, then the author of this little letter says, and God will strengthen you and support you and hold you up in difficult times. There was a lecture several years ago that went viral, as they say. A man named Randy Pausch, I think is how you pronounce his last name. He was a professor at Carnegie Mellon. And every year for his students, he did what he called a last lecture. But this one turned out to be his last lecture because he was suffering from pancreatic cancer. In fact, he died just a couple of months, I think, after giving this lecture to his students. But the lecture is just amazing. I go back and listen to it occasionally. It's just very powerful. Life lessons. There's no pity in there. He uses humor, and it really is stunning. One of the things that has stayed with me is that he says, you know, through all of this, many people have said to him, "Oh, this is so unfair." And he said, you know, it's not unfair. It's unlucky. It's tragic, but it's not unfair because life is a gift. And it's such a simple but wonderful observation in the midst of suffering and death and uncertainty. He said, unfair is when you are assured of something or told one thing and then something else happens. you promised me I would get this promotion and you gave it to so-and-so. That's unfair. Yes. But he said life is a gift. We're given no guarantees, no assurances, because it's all grace. It's God's grace. And I remind myself of that often. And I'm reminded of that when I hear that little phrase that concludes this letter, that the God of all grace will be with you. The God of all grace. So why do you stand there looking up into the heavens, looking up with your head in the clouds? If you want to see God, experience God, look in. Look out to one another. Look out for one another. And the real question underlying all these questions is this an ending or a beginning? And the answer is yes. Hallelujah and amen.
We are not alone. We live in God's world. We believe in God, who has created and is creating, who has come in Jesus, the Word made flesh, to reconcile and make new, who works in us and others by the Spirit. We trust in God. We are called to be the church, to celebrate God's presence, to live with respect in creation, to love and serve others, to seek justice and resist evil, to proclaim Jesus, crucified and risen, our judge and our hope, in life, in death, in life beyond death. God is with us. We are not alone. Thanks be to God.
Let's pray. Loving and merciful God, we bring our gratitude to you who delight in putting us in communities. Be with those who are alone and give us ways to make them feel surrounded by love. We thank you for a family of faith, for those with whom we have shared laughter and tears, for those who have made the world more cheerful, and those who share our sorrows. Creator God, you made the heavens and the earth and all they contain. This beautiful spring has been a blessing to us as we've stayed close to home. The cool air has been refreshing. The flowers and trees have never seemed so beautiful. The creatures we share the world with are thriving and are singing your praise in a glorious symphony. What a gift you have given us. May each kind word, each beautiful sunset, and each glimpse of your goodness open our minds and our souls to the truth of your love. Give us the strength we need to bear witness to that love by doing justice and showing mercy to our neighbors near and far. We ask your blessing on those who are feeling the insecurity of joblessness, those who are suffering illness, those in broken relationship, and those who mourn. Even as we worry about our own safety, help us remember those who live in perilous conditions, unable to keep themselves safe from disease or from those who seek to do them harm. Remind us to be compassionate and to heed Jesus' instructions to feed the hungry, clothe the naked, welcome the stranger, and care for the sick and imprisoned. Jesus told his disciples it was not for them to know the times you have set. So we cast all our anxiety on you, knowing you care for us. Help us to keep alert and stay steadfast in our faith, aware that people all around the world are suffering with us. We trust that you will restore, support, and strengthen us through the grace of Jesus Christ, who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord be kind and gracious to you. May the Lord look upon you with favor and grant you peace from this day forward and forevermore. Amen.